Part 7, Crooks and Spooks. Surprisingly enough, a lot of evidence about alleged mafia involvement in President Kennedy's murder had been assembled and discounted immediately by the Warren Commission. A lot of top hoodlums had made a lot of remarks along the lines of "the guy should be rubbed out" in the period leading up to November 1963. Jimmy Hoffa, the mafia-connected leader of the Teamsters Union, had been under intense investigation by Attorney General RFK, who hated him personally. Hoffa's odious response to the news of the president's death was, "Now Bobby Kennedy's just another lawyer." His Puerto Rico sidekick, Frank Chavez, sent an even more disgusting message to the Attorney General that he was making a collection to clean, beautify, and supply with flowers the grave of Lee Harvey Oswald. Hoffa, among others, was reported as having said that the best way to stop a dog's tail wagging was to cut its head off, meaning that the easiest way to terminate RFK's power and influence would be to get rid of his brother and leave him to inevitable demotion by Lyndon Johnson, no lover of the Kennedy family, which had treated him with barely disguised contempt and distaste. The mafia had some reason to hope that the Kennedy administration would give them an easy run. Joe Kennedy, the president's ambitious father, had made his original fortune as a bootlegger during Prohibition. When alcohol went straight again, so did Joe. But he knew a lot of the boys from the old days, and they had supported his son's bid for the presidency. Sam Giancana, successor to Al Capone as crime king of Chicago, made sure that Cook County, Illinois, Capone's old stamping ground, went for Kennedy in its traditional way. Dead voters were impersonated. Voters who could wangle a double registration did so. Threats were made and bribes were offered where they might work. And the result of the fiddling looked very much as if it had swung the election, for it was a very close-run thing between Kennedy and Nixon in 1960, and Cook County's late return not only came in when it seemed to have made all the difference to a neck-and-neck race, the Kennedy majority in the county contained enough votes to account for the marginal total difference between the contestants. Nixon was aware that he could have called foul and had an electoral court re-examine that result with the hope of overturning Kennedy's election. He chose not to do so, out of respect for the office of president and the unity of the nation. John F. Kennedy had an even more shocking connection with Giancana, as the nation learned in the 1970s. Both were friendly with Frank Sinatra, whose rat pack included the president's brother-in-law, Peter Lawford, and was at that time heir to the old liberal left rat pack dominated by Humphrey Bogart and Lauren Bacall until the House Un-American Activities Committee forced them to keep a lower political profile. Sinatra had thrown his and his friends' influence vigorously into the Democrats' presidential campaigns, and his ties to Kennedy had been so close that he had lavishly refurbished his house in California in the expectation that the President of the United States would be his guest. He had done the President one further service. He introduced pretty actresses and aspirants from Hollywood to Kennedy's bed, a service he not only performed for mafiosi as well, but which actually led to one young lady extending her favours to both Kennedy and Giancana over the same period. It was deeply and seriously shocking to even the most sexually liberal observers to think of Judy Campbell hopping merrily between the president's bed in the White House and the gangster's bed in Chicago. It became worse in the 1980s when Mrs. Judith Exner, as she now was, improved her story with the tale that she had acted as a go-between and carried messages from the gangster to the president. This seemed possible, as it coincided with the time when Kennedy was keenest to destroy Castro and the CIA was known to have been in conversation with gangsters, including Mooney Giancana, about croaking Fidel. This appalling, cozy, triangular relationship of the mobs with the White House through a lady of easy virtue was brought to an end by the vigilance of J. Edgar Hoover. Little though he and the Kennedys liked each other, neither could afford all-out public hostility. And the notorious private files Hoover kept on leading politicians' indiscretions were not merely a blackmailing insurance against his own dismissal. He used them now to prove to President Kennedy that his socialization with the Sinatra crowd and bedroom romps with the mafia-connected chicks they introduced were political dynamite, and for the safety of the presidential office, they'd better stop at once. They did. Sinatra never forgave Kennedy for dropping him abruptly and staying with his Republican rival Bing Crosby in California. Giancana and other mafiosi never forgave the president for allowing his brother to set the FBI onto them after all the comfortable years in which Hoover had insisted there was no such thing as a mafia and hoisted relatively small-time bank robbers like John Dillinger to improbable eminence as public enemy number one. So the mafia, it was argued, had reason to assassinate the president. The companion claim that mafia electronics experts had bugged the president and his brother and had splendid blackmailing tapes of their bedroom jinx with lovers up to and including Marilyn Monroe was always a little hard to square with their complicity in the assassination, however. If, for the first time ever, organized crime had a serving president fairly and squarely between its finger and thumb, tied hand and foot with thoroughly incriminating tapes of his voice and squeaking bedsprings and heavy breathing, instead of the usual vague and deniable indebtedness for campaign contributions and general favours, why on earth would they let him go? What villain in his right mind would really imagine tough, semi-corrupt, self-made Lyndon Johnson, one-time ruler of Capitol Hill, would prove a softer touch than Jack Kennedy, the millionaire's indulged playboy son whose senatorial career had yielded nothing but some glamorous speeches. In fact, there seemed no rational reason for the mafia to assassinate JFK until the publication of Anthony Summers' sensational biography of J. Edgar Hoover in 1993. With Summers' extraordinary claim that Hoover was in the pocket of the mafia, paid off with tips on fixed horse races for him to indulge the profligate betting he adored, a plausible motive emerged. Hoover and the Kennedys detested each other, agreed. Neither dared openly attack each other, agreed. Hoover dared not expose Kennedy's reckless peccadilloes. It would look like an abuse of his office. Nor dared he disobey a direct order from the Attorney General to go after organized crime. Kennedy, on the other hand, dared not exert his presidential power to replace Hoover. He was a national hero to the right. But on the 1st of January 1965, Hoover would go in any case. It was his 70th birthday, and that was that. He had to step down unless the president intervened to waive the statutory retirement age in his case. And nobody doubted that Kennedy would do just the reverse. He would shower the old man with hypocritical public praises and bedeck his barrel chest with prestigious decorations and quietly cheer and cheer and cheer in the privacy of the Oval Office that a dangerous personal enemy had been cleared out of a key post. But if Kennedy were not president and Lyndon Johnson were, well... Lyndon was an old friend and neighbour of Hoover's, a man who shared the director's habit of arm-twisting and threats to remain in power, a man who might secure part of his old right-wing constituency by the unimportant gesture of waiving the retirement age for a cop who was really a bullying bureaucrat and not a cop at all. Whether any top hoodlums predicted it or not, certainly Lyndon Johnson did just that. But the big-name mafiosi, who surface again and again in the conspiracy theorists' history of the assassination, just don't appear in the Warren Report. Chicago's Sam Giancana, New Orleans city boss Carlos Marcello, Santos Trafficante, the Floridian Mr. Big, who managed the contacts back to Cuba, Johnny Rosselli, associated with Trafficante and Giancana in the ludicrous Kill Castro plans, they weren't interviewed or discussed in 1963. for Warren and his team knew nothing whatsoever about the president's sexual and his administration's conspiratorial connections with the rulers of the underworld. They couldn't even connect Oswald with criminals, except for the single unimportant fact that his favourite uncle was a bookmaker in New Orleans. No, it was neither the assassin nor the victim who led Warren's investigators to question mobsters. It was the assassin's assassin. Jack Ruby was a hustler, from a poor district of Chicago, and Jewish. To a certain mindset, which showed up surprisingly often among buffs, those three things together spelled mob. And even before the buffs started on it, the commission's investigators were looking into such little-known figures as David Yarras and Lenny Patrick, boyhood friends of Ruby in Chicago, who later became non-member associates of Chicago organized crime. Joe Civello, who ran Dallas for the mob, and his good friend Joe Campisi. Louis McWillie, who ran gambling for the mob in Dallas and in pre-Castro Cuba. Paul Roland Jones, who tried unsuccessfully to bribe top Dallas policemen into casting a blind eye on syndicate-organized gambling in 1946. All these men could be shown to have met, and most of them occasionally socialized with, Jack Ruby. He had gone on holiday with McWillie in Cuba once, and this added to recollections that as a kid Ruby had run with a gang that loved to carry out small legitimate errands for Al Capone, led researchers to conclude that he had probably come to Dallas from Chicago with mob backing. The shrewder researchers noted that Civello and Campisi were actually organized crime's recognized local rulers, and speculated that Ruby's multiple contacts with the police probably made him their Mr. Fix-It. His trip to Cuba was probably a mob-authorized mission. David Scheim's influential and detailed The Mafia Killed President Kennedy has a section of six chapters on Ruby entitled Mob Fixer in Dallas. Yet all the detailed examples of his fixing activities turn out to be probably indicated by, or based on, many significant reports, or appeared likely. In fact, Ruby was a strip club operator whose recreation was gambling. In America, where most states ban or control off-course betting, and the commercial sex industry is heavily infiltrated by the mob, it is very likely that any serious gambler or strip club owner will number criminals among his acquaintance, unless he restricts his gambling to private friends and occasional visits to Nevada or Atlantic City. And three witnesses claim that Ruby sometimes made book himself. No private off-course American bookmaker can avoid contact with the mob, from whom he will need permission to operate, and from whom he will have to buy the wire service reports of results at racetracks across the country. If the reports are correct, Ruby had to know and deal with mobsters for activities which could be the acceptable work of a small-town businessman in England. Oswald's uncle, Dutz Murrett, has been described as a racketeer in the Marcello Empire on equally flimsy grounds, with the ridiculous rider that Oswald himself became a runner for Marcello when he carried out errands for his uncle. As a strip club owner, Ruby was suspected of winking at or even encouraging his girls to put out. If, as rumour had it, he took a cut of $100 dates fixed up for them after the show, he crossed the boundaries of the law and risked arrest for pimping or breach of the peculiar White Slavery Man Act, which makes it an offence to bring a girl across state boundaries for immoral purposes. And the mob might well ask a few favours from him for the privilege of not having his activities forcefully smashed if he competed with their own prostitution rackets. Ruby, in short, knew crooks because both his business and his pleasure demanded it. And he was by nature a demi-mondaine who liked to play the flashy hustler type. But there's a good deal of evidence that Ruby was such small potatoes that no self-respecting organized mobster would ever have used him for anything. That hasn't stopped mob-related authors from making extravagant claims about Jack Ruby and the syndicate. The most absurd have come from Giancana's brother and nephew, writing in 1992, who claim that Ruby was sent to open up Dallas on behalf of the Chicago mobs, that he was indeed their Mr. Fix-It down there, that he was called upon to organize the town for the assassination and clean up everything afterwards, and he did so. Their account of the assassination itself is utterly ludicrous. They have the book depository stuffed to the gills with well-known mob hitmen, all smuggled into different vantage points, unbeknownst to regular employees, all firing away like billy-o, while Oswald does nothing but slide out of the building, unaware of what he's in the middle of. All silently escaping, without a soul noticing something like the Appalachian mob convention making a quick getaway through the crowded plaza on their alligator wing-tipped toes. Even the buffs decline to accept this twaddle as history, though much of the story is drawn from their works, as is shown by the mysterious momentary mention of a top-notch hitman from the Marcello outfit called Jack Lawrence, who made an appearance in the first impression of the Giancana's book, only to disappear from its pages between the review copies and first sales. Somebody had realized that serious libel proceedings might be taken if they published this outrageous description of a completely innocent church pastor, a young garage hand at the time of the shooting, whose presence among the spectators near the Triple Underpass had been built up by the buffs into a stand-by marksman, all because he had moved around the country too often for them to trace him, while he was quite unaware of their monstrous and libelous speculations. Louis Witt, he of the eccentric anti-Kennedy demonstration, suffered a similar fate, being known to the buffs for years as the Umbrella Man, and speculatively charged with having used his umbrella to signal the start of the shooting, or even fire a poisoned pellet from its ferrule. The FBI had in fact looked carefully at Ruby's known criminal associates in 1963 and dismissed them as low-level, casual and unimportant, even though the dispute with AGVA, the strippers' union, had sent Ruby running to some of them for assistance just before the president's visit to Dallas. As for the various stories that Ruby was seen with Oswald shortly before the shooting, they all fall under that mistaken identity heading we've seen in connection with anti-Castro Cubans. The most interesting and detailed of these, a report by a young woman that she saw and looked closely at Jack Ruby in a truck near the Triple Underpass, from which Oswald took a gun and hurried up to the picket fence, has been quite exploded now the actual truck driver and his mate have been identified. They were moving perfectly ordinary workmen's equipment. Other witnesses, who claimed to have seen Oswald and Ruby together, appear to have mistaken the Carousel Club's young temporary handyman Larry Crawford for Oswald. Ruby took a lie detector test, and allowing for his mental state at the time, passed it. He did not know Oswald. His mental state when the Warren Commission interviewed him was indeed parlous. Flamboyant lawyer Melvin Belli's handling of his defence had lost him his case and won him a death sentence. Death row depressed him deeply, and in paranoid depression he believed that Jews were being killed in the basement of the Dallas jail, hence his urgent requests to Earl Warren to get him out to Washington, something the buffs have elevated to his fear of mafia revenge if he told the truth. Elmer Gertz, who handled the appeal that commuted Ruby's capital sentence, knew him and his case well, and never doubted for a moment that the Warren Commission's account of Ruby's actions over the weekend of the 22nd of November were absolutely accurate. As he and Ruby both observed, had not little Lynn, the stripper, run out of cash, Ruby wouldn't even have been in place to kill Oswald. Was she supposed to be a co-conspirator? No. There's not a shred of evidence to suggest a mafia conspiracy to kill Kennedy, and it would not really make much sense for there to be one. There's not a shred of evidence to suggest that the CIA and the mob extended their joint activities from plotting against Castro to plotting against the man whose government had brought them together. But spooks are secretive by nature. The CIA did not tell the Warren Commission about their silly and dangerous plans. It brought them into plenty of disrepute when they finally came out, so one can understand their silence. And one can understand why Buffs were suspicious and angry that Alan Dulles, long the CIA's boss, gave his fellow commissioners no hint of the irresponsibility of his agency, which might be interpreted as having put the president at risk. And the FBI was equally secretive. J. Edgar Hoover always placed an exorbitantly high rating on the image of the Bureau he'd turned from a corrupt and mistrusted body of investigators into one of the world's great police forces. He dreaded repercussions when it emerged that his agents had interviewed Oswald 9 times as a former defector and continuing dissident without suspecting his lethal propensities. He limited the testimony placed before the commission to place the agency in the best light. And he made a rational, but arguably premature decision, from the outset, that there was no need to look for co-conspirators, only evidence against Oswald. And that's the measure of it. There was no mafia conspiracy to kill the president on behalf of anti-Castro Cubans and embittered CIA renegades who felt let down by the White House. The various crooks who've confessed to reporters that they were implicated in or aware of a conspiracy have lied in their teeth or passed on the sort of jailhouse and barroom gossip that may well come from sordid men trying to inflate their sordid lives. Which is pretty much what Lee Harvey Oswald was, too.